the presentation and the visualizer with the title page of the course. All right. So let me briefly remind where we are now. So our purpose is to describe all possible two-dimensional geometries which may be obtained from the SL2R group. And to this end, we started from the consideration of associated homogeneous spaces where this group act by transitive transformations. And again, that follow that action on the homogeneous spaces follows from the structure of corresponding one parameter continuous subgroups. And we find out what there are exactly three different one parameter continuous subgroup for SL2R. And when we calculate corresponding action in terms of suitable parameterization, in turn, it's turned out what there are three types of hypercomplex numbers which appears, which we called hyperbolic, parabolic, and elliptic for reasons which became clear from the geometrical picture which we have obtained. When we study corresponding Möbius transformation or hypercomplex numbers, when we use decomposition of SL2R again into respective three subgroups A and K, and subgroup A and N act independently from the type of hypercomplex numbers which we have used. And difference appears when we introduce subgroup K, when depending from the type of numbers, either we use complex numbers, dual numbers, or double numbers, orbits of subgroup K became either circles, parabolas, or hyperbolas. And that justify the name which we have used in the classification of these three different geometries which we have. And we also noted what if we introduce sorry, parameter sigma, which is equal to the square root of the corresponding imaginary unit. So sigma may have value equal to minus 1, 0, or 1. When a lot of formulas can be written in a unified way. So usage of that sigma help, for example, to express the corresponding vector fields, which are infinitesimal generators for corresponding transformations. It's allowed to write it in uniform way. And at this point, we may recall what circles, parabolas, and hyperbolas, which we seen on this picture, are known as conic section, and they really are obtainable as the section of corresponding cones, and that is helpful in various setup. We may try to find that unified picture. So again, our approach is to unify all three cases as much as possible. So we may try to find certain cone which will produce corresponding orbits as their sections. And that is possible indeed. So here is the three-dimensional picture. The left-hand side contains just a projection, and in the right-hand side it's drawn in three dimensions. So we are considering the cone generated by the its right and right-angled cone. So generator of cone make a right angle and the vertex. And so we put the vertex of this cone in the three dimensions to certain hyperbola. So here is a hyperbola. If we put the vertex of this cone into that hyperbola, then possible sections of a cone by the horizontal plane will be exactly circles which appears in the complex situation. So this is the orbit of subgroup K in complex situation. So here is, while that left picture is on the presentation screen, so we will consider section of this cone by three planes. One is horizontal, it's denoted EE prime. Another make angle 45 degree PP prime. And then vertical plane denoted HH prime. So it's elliptic, parabolic and hyperbolic cases. In parabolic case, the plane is parallel to the generator of the cone, and hyperbolic plane parallel to the axis of the cone, and then elliptic is perpendicular to the axis of the cone. When corresponding parabolic and elliptic parabolic and hyperbolic section of the same cone will appear as parabolas and hyperbolas corresponding to the orbit K. Again, if you will look on the orbits which we have here for parabolas, hyperbolas, and circles, you will see what not any circle is orbit of subgroup K. It's special orbit, special circles, and similarly here special parabolas and some special hyperbolas, which indeed require what the vertex of the cone belong to the same hyperbola in all three cases. So this is how we may geometrically unify all three orbits of subgroup K. In fact, the movement along that orbit happen when we are rotating this cone around its axis. So here is the corresponding picture which unifies the all three previous pictures, elliptic, parabolic and hyperbolic section on the same drawing. So now I put it all together. So if it will be shown first, that picture may look a little bit messy, but now I hope you can separate it into corresponding parts, elements. So here, if generator of the cone, that black generator, will be rotated along the cone, then corresponding point will draw on the section planes is a circle, parabola and hyperbola, and it will be exactly correspond to respective parameter T in the subgroup K. You remember subgroup K consists of matrices cosine, sine, minus sine, cosine, T. So that parameter T is exactly parameter of rotation of this cone. So here is a kind of unification which we have obtained for all three geometries which consider it. But it's geometrical, it's maybe even aesthetically appealing, but it's a bit difficult to handle it. So it's maybe an advantage if we will look for certain algebraic unification, not so geometrical maybe one. And that unification will appear in certain construction. But before we will move to that unification, let us describe what will be our main object to consider. As you remember, according to Felix Klein, geometry is investigation of invariance under transitive group action. So natural object to consider within that approach is a family of objects which are invariant. So family shall be invariant, element of that family shall be transformed back to elements of this family. And if again we come back to the corresponding action into the of subgroup K, we may suspect what in elliptic case corresponding family consists of circles, and parabolas and hyperbolas correspond to dual and double numbers. And that indeed can be proven. So at least that fact is very well known in complex case. Möbius transformation with complex numbers always map a circle or a line into a circle or a line. So for unification purpose, it's worth to consider straight lines as circles with infinite radius. So then we will be simply speaking about the circles, but understanding straight lines as very special degenerate case of circles. And then Möbius transformation with complex numbers map circles to the circles. And we also introduce a respective family of parabolas, parabolas with vertical axis and respectively horizontal directrice. That parabolas will be again an invariant family under transformation with dual numbers. And if we consider right angled hyperbolas with again vertical axes, then that will be an invariant family for double numbers transformations. And here we present a simple almost proof. So some calculations here are missing, and apart from these calculations, so the proof is more or less very simple. So again, I recall what we can decompose any element of SL to R into product of element from subgroup A, subgroup N, and subgroup K. And what subgroup A act by dilation, subgroup N act by horizontal shift. This is transformation which preserve shape. So scaling or shift preserve circles, parabolas, and hyperbolas. So clearly, objects are invariant under such transformation. So to make our proof complete, we need to go to case of subgroup K, which preserve only conic section of respective kind. So our argument will be as follow. Using that Iwasawa decomposition into element A and K, we can decompose our general transformation G, or we can precede that transformation G by certain elements which put given circle, so we are trying to demonstrate what a given circle C will be transformed to some other circle. So argument will be as follow. By horizontal shift, we are able to move center of our circle to the imaginary axis. That will be a transformation from subgroup N. Then we, by scaling, can achieve what circle which we obtain with center on imaginary axis will be scaled to one of the orbit. And it's a part where calculation is necessary, really. The equation of these orbits here for subgroup K is such what any circle can be scaled exactly to one such orbit. When we apply transformation from subgroup K, which preserve such circles properly scaled, and after that we may supply again shift and scaling, which does not disturb shape of our conic section, horizontal shift and some scaling, which put our conic section to final position. So given a circle and given a Möbius transformation with element G, that decomposition allow us to show what resulting element will be again a circle. So that is the proof. Illustration is provided only for circles, but proof along these lines can be given also for parabolas and hyperbolas. That proof may be, again, it has some advantage what it does not use much calculation, at least we are hidden here with calculations. It's in the part of scaling to orbit of subgroup K. But we will have some other proof later of the same statement, what corresponding circles, parabolas, and hyperbolas are invariant. And from now on, we will call that conic section as cycles. So cycle mean a corresponding conic section for that particular situation, either a circle, parabola, or hyperbola. Once we understand the geometry of Möbius transformations in the upper half plane, we would like to come back from other point of view. Well, again, in this course, we start from SL to R, consider it one parameter subgroup. We came to the conclusion what there are three equally generated, equally treated Möbius type of Möbius transformation of three different types of hypercomplex numbers. Theoretically, you can start from other side. You can start just from complex numbers, hypercomplex number, dual and double, and say what you wish to study corresponding Möbius transformation. And then you may ask what group are fixing the imaginary unit. And for complex numbers, that is really, if you will compare with the orbit of subgroup K, you will see what subgroup K is exactly subgroup which fix imaginary unit I. So it's like a hyperbolic rotation in the Lobachevsky rotation around the imaginary unit. In the subgroup, in the case of dual numbers, in hyperbolic case, if you have a transformation which fix the imaginary unit, it will also fix the light cone passing that imaginary unit. So because that geometry, a Minkowski type geometry of the space-time here appear, so that light cone is fixed, and corresponding group turns to be group of the hyperbolic rotation with elements cosine hyperbolic, sine hyperbolic, sine hyperbolic, cosine hyperbolic. So as you can see, group which appear here is very similar to subgroup K, but with only hyperbolic function is used. And here shall not be a minus sign, because for hyperbolic function we have identity what cosine hyperbolic squared minus sine hyperbolic squared giving 1. So determinant of this matrix is equal 1 without minus sign, unlike in subcase of K. And that subgroup A, it is similar, there is conjugated to subgroup A, which we considered before. There are the conjugation group here. And finally, for dual numbers, subgroup which fixed the imaginary unit, it will also fix the entire imaginary axis. So again, this is the structure of dual numbers, structure of divisors of zeros, if you want, which request what all that point shall be fixed. And corresponding transformation shown in the middle, and a group which produce that parabolic rotation around the parabolic imaginary unit is subgroup n prime of lower triangular matrices. Again, that subgroup n prime is conjugated to subgroup n, so it's lower triangular matrices. Again, we may, all that subgroup can be uniformly written as exponent of such traceless matrix, which is in the Lie group, 0 sigma t, t 0. So exponent of that element from the Lie algebra produce one parameter subgroup which fix corresponding imaginary unit in corresponding cases. Now we need to discuss the issue which related with linear fractional Möbius transformation. That is given a certain fraction, we are doing division, and even with complex numbers, division is not always possible. We cannot divide by zero normally. And situation even worse if we are considering dual and double numbers, because there are divisors of zeros. We cannot divide not only by zero in this situation, but also we cannot divide by divisors of zeros. So something shall be done. Well, in case of complex number, the respective construction is very well known. It's called compactified complex plane, or which is in one-to-one correspondence with Riemann sphere. So we are not able to divide by zero. So for wet division which appear, we assign a special element which we call infinity, and we attach wet infinity to the plane in certain topological way. And best to make visual wet correspondence with additional plane in term of with additional point in term of stereographic projection. So this is upper drawing here. So Riemann sphere is thought to be in one-to-one correspondence when we are doing a projection from the north pole point S, when a line passing point Q on the plane intersect the sphere exactly in one point P, and this is make a correspondence of points of the plane to the green points of the sphere. So the only exception from that correspondence is north pole itself, and somehow P approaching the point S if Q tends to infinity. In whatever direction you put Q phi away, the corresponding point of the sphere P will be approaching the point S. In the limiting situation, so it will be just tangent line to the sphere, which passed point S. Tangent line, so parallel to the plane, it does not intersect plane, we will call what it's pass the infinity. This is what happens with complex numbers. We have just one exceptional point zero. We cannot divide by it. So we add that imaginary north pole and make compactification in terms of units sphere, Riemann sphere. What happens with dual numbers? With dual numbers, if you remember, we have divisors of zeros, which are all points of the form lambda epsilon, because square will be equal to zero. So this is divisors of zero. So entire imaginary axis is exceptional. We cannot divide by these numbers in linear fractional transformation. And we still want to have Nurbis transformation to be one-to-one map between a proper compactified object. So we need add to our plane some, say, straight line of additional elements. And that compactification can be done with the help of cylinder, its second picture here. So similarly to the sphere case, you put a stereographic projection from point S. For any point Q on the plane, that line passing S and Q will intersect cylinder in one additional point, which called point P, and only points of the red line does not correspond to any point on the plane. This is new additional points which we add to infinity, and there are certain algebraic rules of doing linear fractional transformation which assign that result on that new additional points at infinity. When we come to double numbers, again, as we already discussed this, with double numbers, divisors of zero form the light cone. So if this is J, divisors of zero form lines 1 plus J lambda times 1 plus J, or lambda 1 minus J. So these two straight lines make an exceptional points which are not permitted, normally not permitted in as value of denominator. So we again need to make a compactification by adding that corresponding number of ideal new points. And that compactification can be done using the hyperboloid, one-sheet hyperboloid of rotation. And we still have a stereographic projection from the point S, where is the correspondence to any point Q of the plane to green points of the hyperboloid, except that two crossed lines which belong to hyperboloid and present that images of divisors of zeros under Möbius transformation. The picture in a sense is not complete. It algebraically satisfactory, so we can now make define our Möbius transformation as one-to-one map on this compactified surface. But there are some physical and mathematical reasons why we will need to extend that picture, and we will discuss it later in appropriate place of this course. So, as I told you, we already built the nice geometrical unification of all situation as conic section, and that picture geometrically satisfactory, but to make manipulation, to make calculation, we will prefer an algebraic tool, algebraic language to unify all situation. And that can be done through the Schwertfeger-Filmer-Springer-Knops construction. So that is a kind of approach which was independently discovered by many people, and that four names are not all people who came to that construction independently and believe what they discovered for the first time, but somehow I choose them just to represent that construction. So there are later work and maybe some unknown work to me which use similar ideas independently. And point is as follow. We can represent analytically conic section as a null solution or roots of certain quadratic expression. So it's given here. So there are parameters K, L, N, and M, which produce particular conic section. Here, the type of conic section is defined by the square of imaginary unit in this place. So if square is minus one, then we have circle. If square is equal to zero, then we have parabola. If square is equal one, we have a hyperbola here. So this is equation of corresponding cycle in respective geometry. So we need just four real numbers, K, L, N, M, to specify an arbitrary cycle in the plane. And that points, elements of four real numbers, really define the cycle up to the scalar factor, because if we multiply simultaneously all four numbers by, say, lambda, then it will be exactly the same equation in term of U and V. So it's linear in term of K, L, N, M, so we can consider such scaling. And then we treat that point of three real numbers up to a scalar factor. That is naturally in mathematical language known as a point of three-dimensional projective space. So in fact, that cycles which we are studying, they are parameterized by point of three-dimensional projective space. That is already something, but it's turned out what for a reason which we will see soon. What if we want to make official computation with that points in three-dimensional projective space, we better will arrange that four numbers in a matrix, this matrix here, and that will be called that Schwertfeger-Filmer-Springer-Knops matrix. Now, maybe make it shorter, I will say just matrix representation of cycle. You see that four numbers K, L, and M are arranged in a special way. Moreover, when we build this matrix, we put here some additional imaginary unit. So once our theory is already using imaginary unit, we put here some additional imaginary unit in the matrix. So it's again imaginary unit of a type which we considered before. So it's squared either to minus 1, 0, and 1. But we will see what behavior of this imaginary unit in the matrix is really independent from the behavior of imaginary unit which we used on the left in the quadratic equation which define the corresponding conic section. And it's quite fruitful to consider that two different imaginary units and different combination of them, different combination of their values that produce interesting geometrical results. And immediately with respect to wet conic sections and with respect to corresponding drawing of this conic section is possible to introduce the object which called the center of a conic section. It's connected to the center of a circle. If our conic section is drawn as a circle, it's connected to it. Actually, what I shall say after we already mentioned what equation of conic section is defined by that four real numbers up to projective scaling. And so once you forget about equation and keep only parameters, you may come back from these parameters back to equation in three different ways. So if you have four real numbers, you can think about these four real numbers defining either circle or parabola or hyperbola in this equation. And so you may draw the corresponding curve for the same value of parameters. And here there is an example. So for the same value of parameters, I draw a circle. If that circle does not intersect the real line, then corresponding parabola and corresponding hyperbola does not intersect real line as well. But if we have a circle which intersect, if that parameters KLMN define a circle which intersects the real line in two points, then both parabolas and hyperbolas will pass the same points as well. So roots, it's again possible to see from the equation. If you are looking for a roots of that equation, intersection with the real line, so you put V here equal to zero, and once V is equal to zero, the sign of I squared is not important. So roots are the same for all three drawing. And then again, once we introduce that representation of the same cycle, either by parabola, or hyperbola, or circle, we associate to them so-called center. Center here is again may have three different value. So I put here it's sigma brief, and that sigma brief is square of I brief from the matrix. So that center can coincide with the center of circle when it's called elliptic center. It can be its mirror reflection in the real line when it will be hyperbolic center of that conic section, or it will be point in the middle on the real line that is parabolic center of that conic section. As you will see, that centers play a certain role in geometry of cycles. Here is the summary. We have different point of view on our cycles. So they either thought as a point of three-dimensional projective space. We may think about them in this way. We may build out of these parameters the corresponding matrix representation, and operate with these matrices, or we may draw them as certain conic section on respective planes, either elliptic, parabolic, or hyperbolic. So there are different point of view on this correspondence, and then different result can be appeared. Whenever we have that projective space, projective type space, it will be better to eliminate excessive degree of freedom, so we can multiply all parameters by the same number lambda and get the same equation, the same quadric. So it will be better to eliminate that degree of freedom by division certain or certain normalization. So if our parameter k, the parameter in front of the quadratic terms, if our parameter k is not equal to zero, then we can simply divide by this k the entire coordinates, and that it will lead to so-called k-normalization of our cycle. So in that form, whenever we can divide, so it's again something which is typical to do, it's common to do in the analytical geometry when we look for the canonical equation for certain conic section. And we will, of course, this is not always possible. If k equal to zero, that normalization does not make anything. There are a second normalization which is useful. We called it here Kirillov normalization. And that is given by the condition what determinant of corresponding matrix of a cycle shall be equal to one. Again, we can divide our parameters by certain values to achieve that unless our determinant of matrix is zero. So if you have non-zero determinant of the matrix, you can normalize it to have value one. If it's equal to zero, then that normalization is not possible. So let's investigate closely that connection or what is geometrical meaning of the determinant for that matrix. So a determinant of corresponding matrix representing a cycle is given by that formula, so it's easy to calculate. That second sigma appears here in front of n squared. And when we introduce additional points associated to a cycle, which defined in term of the determinant, so it's a point with such a coordinates, and that coordinate is defined through the determinant, and geometrically that point correspond to the foci of the our cycle drawn as parabola. So again, the same cycle can be drawn in either way, a circle, parabola, or hyperbola. The center, as we introduce it, correspond to such drawing as circles, and that point, which is a focus, is correspond to drawing as a parabola. And here, really, center position of the center for a parabola depend from its focal length. So here I draw two cycles as parabola. They have the same vertical position of the centers, and that represents the fact that they have the same focal length. And when elliptic, well, when parabolic focus, parabolic in the sense of that second imaginary unit, is simply vertex of parabola, hyperbolic focus of cycle corresponds its ordinary focus, and the elliptic one will be a reflection of hyperbolic into parabolic, and this is a point of the directrice of parabola. So that again something which has both geometrical and analytical meaning. So we introduce that point using algebraic relation with determinant of certain matrix, and it's turned out what it's geometrically significant if our cycle is drawn as parabola. So I already mentioned what it may be a special case when determinant of the cycle is equal to zero. In particular, Kirillov normalization in this situation is not possible. We cannot scale determinant to value one. What is geometrical meaning? Which cycles happen to have determinant equal to zero? So again, what we will oftenly see later, we have nine situations. So we may use three value of a different imaginary unit in our equation, that means in our drawing. We may draw our cycle as circles, parabolas, or hyperbola. And independently, we may use three different values for second imaginary unit, which appear in the matrix. So if they coincide with two imaginary units, then situation somehow may be simpler, but for completeness of the theory, it's worth to consider all nine cases. If we calculate the determinant of matrix elliptically and draw that cycle elliptically, then elliptic zero determinant just represents a point that is really a radius of a circle, and when it shrinks to zero, so circle is shrinked to a single point, to its center. So that is that green point here represent the drawing, elliptic drawing of a cycle with the elliptic zero determinant. If we calculate our determinant parabolically, then it doesn't matter either you draw your cycle elliptically or parabolically. It will be a corresponding point section which touch the real axis. Sorry, I have a problem with the sound.
I don't know.
Everything here shows what sound is transmitted. Can you hear me?
Oh. Let's hope it will be...
No, it's battery count, yes.
Can you hear me now? Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, battery gun during the lecture. All right, so if we parabolically calculate determinant, then it doesn't matter how you draw your cycle, either a circle, parabola, or hyperbola, it will be touching the real line. So it's, rather straightforward. If you will ask the when that the quadratic equation has the double root, double real root, that means touching the real axis, when discriminant of that quadratic equation is exactly determinant of that matrix. So it's equal to zero. That means you have a double root in that quadratic equation. So that is explain geometrical significance of that. And when our discriminant, determinant, when our determinant is hyperbolically equal to zero, then again, it doesn't matter how you draw your cycle, either a circle, parabola, or hyperbola, the condition which you will obtain is the intersection of the your cycle with the real axis under 45 degrees, as you can see on this picture. So that last three cycles intersect the real axis with 45 degrees. But again, can be derived from this equation, so you can calculate the corresponding implicit derivative, and you will see what happened with the tangent vector to the conic line. And if we calculate hyperbolic determinant equal to zero and draw our cycle as a hyperbola, then hyperbola degenerate to the light cone. So in this, in hyperbolic case, you do not have your cycle do not of zero radius. It does not shrink to the point. If you will think what will happen with a parabola when it's approach to the center of parabola, so it's really degenerate to the light cone. So rather than shrinking to the point, as that happened with the circle. So that light cones continuously appear in our course, and that light cones at certain point are really represent the zero radius parabola. So we will later see why determinant of that determinant of this matrix can be treated as corresponding radiuses, or square of the radiuses. At this point, I would like somehow to explain to you what will be in exam and what material will be covered. So from now on, I will speak about quite funny and fancy geometry of dual, double, and complex numbers. And this result are interesting in my opinion, but that somehow an optional part of the course, it's not examinable. So what is examinable from that geometrical part is essentially construction of homogeneous spaces. That will be important. So the first part, which has great importance, and we will see in the remaining geometrical part of the course a lot of pictures. I try to explain to you some interesting property which are illustrated by this picture, but you are not obliged to memorize them and get deep knowledge. I hope you will just enjoy them, so it's not for the exam. Questions for this lecture? Okay, thank you for coming. Don't forget a question. Yeah. Sorry, I did not follow your question. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, yes, yeah, yeah. Yes, it's, yes, we have here a group property, yes. So Möbius transformation comes from the group, and so if you apply it to corresponding conic section, the result will be that conic section, so yes. Yeah. Which one? Ah, S, yes, I did not say yes. S is and some additional parameter, somehow it's useful for the theory, and it usually take value is a zero, as again, it's like a sigma, take zero, minus one and one. It's additional value, which sometimes useful to inject there in the matrix. Maybe theory may be somehow optimized to remove that as for, but at the moment I do not have such optimization. So sometimes it's useful to have that S here. Yes, it's take the same value as the sigmas. Yeah, thank you. So.